So there was no scope of review. Now, solid smokeless fuel naturally fell out of favor in the 90s because people were moving into gas. There was hardly any solid smokeless fuel being produced. But the coal supply could not be stopped. Any effort, all efforts that we made to supply, stop those coal supplies, landed us into courts. And courts said nothing doing, NDUs, you have not checked this, that, and supply could not be stopped. That was the moral of the game. We got a study done in N90s, 98-99, by Tata Energy Research Institute on the sectoral demand of coal. And there a very interesting thing came up. They were particularly focusing on the brick sector. The brick sector consumes, based on the number of bricks produced in the country and consumption and all that, it's clear that the brick sector consumes not less than 22 million tons of coal. Whereas the official supply to the brick sector from Coal India, and Coal India is the only supplier, is 2 million tons. So this huge gap of 20 million tons was an eye-opener. So that means this is this brick sector would be one of those fellows you saw in the, in the film, basically driving a cart to somebody. So they were the sufferers who were depending on the grey market for their coal supplies. Then the Coal India Vigilance Department, they did a very smart thing. They advertised in post box, without giving the consumer number, based on a post box number, in various newspapers in the coal bearing areas, wanting to buy 1,000 tons of solid smokeless fuel. These advertisements were given regularly. Not a single advertisement evoked a single response, which made it quite clear that possibly this was not being produced. In Dhanbad, it was very clear to us that the delivery orders we were giving to these fellows were changing hands, as I said in that TV, that film, changing hands number of times, and everybody was making money. And the company didn't have money to pay provident fund. So we said, this can't go on. So ultimately we decided, and with a lot of stress and strength, to introduce electronic auction of coal for that quantity, 5 million tons. We got a very special approval from the Prime Minister's office. E-auction was not adopted by then as a policy. The government thought that let the trial start and policy formulation can come later. So we started the e-auction process. We conducted huge number of road shows across the country, taking help of Metal Junction, and there was another service provider. I think I did mention in the film, but that name was cut out. MSTC. Those were also there. So both of them together had number of road shows. But the people took us to courts. There were 22 high court cases against BCCL. Particularly BCCL was the pioneer to do it. Then it was extended to other subsidiaries of Coal India. So everybody was dragged into court. Ultimately, all these cases converged in Supreme Court. There was a very long hearing. After the hearing, no judgment was coming. After a long time, a judgment came. And in that judgment, the e-auction was scrapped. It was scrapped because it was not backed by a government policy. At the same time, the judgment allowed that if a policy is set up by a competent committee under the chairmanship of the Secretary Coal, then you can think about that. So we quickly got that committee constituted. The committee was broad-based. That committee recommended that at least 10% of the coal should be put up under e-auction. E-auction, what it meant was, it allowed anybody to access coal. That was the most important part of it. That you will not find anybody suffering like that in the film, because he knows where to go. I mean, he's just to log on. It has to pay a higher price, there's no doubt. But that higher price is not 5 times. It is 40% or 50% or 60% coal. And that money comes to the company, put into productive use. So the company also, it's a basically win-win situation. You eliminate middlemen. That's the best part of it. And you provide access to anybody and everybody. No questions asked. You can use that coal to brush your teeth. So no problems. Nobody is going to question. So this process, actually, we did, definitely transparency was one of the looming ideas. The transparency has to be introduced. But honestly speaking, it may help my company. At least in the first year, 2005-06, 250 crores of additional premium is what we generated. Because that was all good coal. And the money was rightfully ours. And that definitely helped the process of conversion of this company into profits. That's how it all went. Subsequent to this e-auction story is over. Now, can I take 2 more minutes? Okay, fine. When I came to Coal India, you see, basically as I said, the story was not that good all the time. We ultimately managed to get Navaratna in 2008. It came with a condition that you have to get yourself listed, because we were the only Navaratna company unlisted. Other 17 were all listed. So a condition of 3 years was there, and if it has not happened in 3 years' time, then the Navaratna could have been taken back. So that issue of listing came up. When the issue of listing came up, we really found how understated the company is. Nobody has really understood, nobody thought about the company. So first time we started saying certain things. Well, this is a company which provides more than 40% of primary commercial energy to this country. It does that at 50% of world prices, and therefore makes the end users competitive, enables the users to be competitive. And this advantage is brought without any dependence of any subsidy on anybody. It doesn't need any subsidy. Rather, it earns money and pays to the government a substantial sum of money where we have dividends and taxes. These were the initial statements we started making. But then other issues came up. What are you doing about environment? What are you doing about restoration and reclamation? Your track record is not good. There was a big doubt whether we really do or not do. And sitting in Coal India, head office at Calcutta, I am not really sure whether we do or don't do. I am also not sure. I can visit one or two mines. And naturally, when I visit the mines, the tendency will be to take me to a mine where it is all good, well done. So that's not comfortable enough. So we used our CMPDI to introduce a satellite surveillance on the open cast mines, basically the land reclamation and restoration work. That was really fantastic, because the satellite images of all the large projects were put on the website of Coal India, and year after year. So if you compare two images of two successive years, and if you find that the blacked out area, mined area, will always be black in the satellite image, if that has widened, it means commensurate restoration reclamation has not been done. Very easy for a layman to conclude. And if it has shrunk, in spite of higher production being done from those mines, then better than commensurate land restoration reclamation has been done. As simple as that. So this gave us a very clear way of communicating to ourselves and to the world that what's happening on land restoration and reclamation in large projects. Not only that, this enabled at least 53 open cast projects to become ISO 14001 compliant. They got ISO 14001 certification, which is environmental standards. So that helped us to tell the world, well, this company believes in environment management and it tries to do whatever is needed to be done, tries to do its best. In terms of afforestation, there's a huge issue on afforestation. Afforestation, we have set up a track record of afforesting 2.5 acres of land for every 1 acre of forest land that we consume, that we degrade. Much better things can be done. We are aware of that. The company is aware of that. The company is taking steps to, in fact, review and change its afforestation policy. What we do is not really fully optimal. We can do better. I don't want to describe the negative things right now. I've just retired only 4 months back. Maybe 1 year later I'll do that. But it is trying to do whatever it can. On the resettlement rehabilitation, the policies are absolutely clear. If you go to tribal villages nearby, you will see what kind of efforts has gone in there. There are some committed people who really make a difference. Basically, the resettlement rehab policy is centered on one philosophy: to make a distinct qualitative difference in the lifestyle. Bring them to education, bring them medical facilities and things like that. I can recall one small story here. I'll try to end after that. I visited one of these mines called Rajmahal Open Cast Mine. It is in Jharkhand. And that supplies coal to NTPC, Farakka and Kahalgaon, 11 million ton mine. And now it is, I think, 14 million tons. So there, it is all tribal area. So all tribal rehabilitation has to be done. So there was an occasion, function sort of thing. People were dancing and all that. And two young girls came to, you know, pour water on the feet and wash feet and all that. I tried to prevent them. One of them in chaste English tells me that, sir, this is our culture. Allow us to do it. Then I asked her, what's her name? Where does she study? She studies in a DAV school in class 12. And that made me feel very proud, because that school is done by us. Medical facilities are there. You can see the body language. You can see the health of the people. You have a tribal lady, 20 kilometer shovel operator. She drives a 20 kilometer shovel. I think this is again women empowerment. So all these things put together, when we put into the red herring prospectus, I think people started looking at it. To become the most valuable company, it is not enough to be really making, paying dividends or paying money. You know, today global investors don't invest like that. So they all look at your records on transparency, they look at records on resettlement, rehabilitation, on what you do to environment, how green you are, and all these things are looked into and then people decide. And basically with only global investors, basically 60% of the investments is global. So that is what propels a share price. And so people who are attributing Coal India's most valued company to monopoly status, I completely disagree with that. Because if you look at the prices, the price at which we sell coal even today, particularly to the power sector, which is the largest consumer, 75% coal goes to that power sector, is 50% of world price. So selling coal at 50% of the world prices, if you are making 15,000 crores of profits, I think there is some efficiency somewhere. It can't be all that bad. Thank you very much.